In this video, we will try to describe the idea of fugacity, why it's important, where it comes from, why we're interested in using it. And we'll start out by looking at two phases, an alpha phase and a beta phase. We won't specify any more about the phases right now. But what we're showing is the concentration of component A in each of the phases. And initially, these phases are not in equilibrium. And the question is, which direction does component A move? What's direction of mass transfer to get to equilibrium? We're always looking at how systems approach equilibrium. And in this case, we might look and say, well, a very high concentration of A in this phase, we might expect mass transfer to go to the lower concentration. However, for this particular system, if this phase was water vapor, and this phase was liquid water, and we were at 45 degrees C, then mass transfer would be in this direction. Because this concentration, if we look at steam tables, is actually higher than saturation pressure. So equilibrium would be a decrease to saturation pressure. And so this means we can't use concentration as our determination of direction of mass transfer. Certainly concentration matters in that it affects fugacity, but we're going to use fugacity or chemical potential as our determining factor. If the chemical potential is higher in the alpha phase than the beta phase, so chemical potential in the alpha is higher than the beta, and therefore mass transfer goes from alpha to beta. And another way of looking at this, it means the fugacity of water is higher in the alpha phase than the beta phase. So the chemical potential is related to the Gibbs free energy, and we use Gibbs free energy. We look at this a couple ways, but the Gibbs free energy in the vapor phase would be the enthalpy per mole or per kilogram. Vapor phase minus the temperature times the entropy in the vapor phase. And at equilibrium, that enthalpy in the liquid phase minus TS, so G in the vapor phase, G in the liquid phase, those are equal at equilibrium. That turns out to be our criteria for equilibrium. And if we rearrange this equation, we notice H vapor minus H liquid over temperature is S vapor minus S liquid, which means delta H of vaporization over temperature is equal to delta S of vaporization. Heat of vaporization divided by temperature is the entropy change of vaporization. This is how we originally derived entropy, where entropy change we defined as dQ reversible over T, and for phase change, T is constant, Q is delta H when we carry out vaporization at constant pressure. And so this equation follows from our definition of entropy, and it shows us the Gibbs free energy is the same in both phases. So let's look at how we get fugacity from Gibbs free energy, and we'll go back to the first law. Closed reversible system, change internal energy, differential change is the heat added and the work added. If it's reversible, then we can write dQ in terms of entropy change. And again, if it's reversible, we can write work as minus PdV. Now, delta H is defined as delta U plus delta PV, or dH is dU plus dPV. So we can make the substitution from dU. These two terms cancel, and dH is TdS plus VdP. And now one more step, dG, dH. So we're making the same type, again, substitution, dH, TdS plus VdP minus TdS minus SdT. So the change, differential change in Gibbs free energy, and again, you notice this term cancels, VdP minus SdT. And so what we're going to look at for a lot of our calculations is what happens if we look at changes at constant temperature. Then dG is VdP. So we can calculate the change in Gibbs free energy from volume and pressure changes at constant temperature. And when we look at, for example, an ideal gas, what the change is going to look like, Then dg for an ideal gas is rt over p dp. Well, remember the volume I'm using here is the specific volume, the volume per mole. So rt dp over p. And so this means change in Gibbs free energy for an ideal gas is rt d log of p. And so what's been done then for real gas is to say, we like this form, so we're going to introduce a new variable called the fugacity. It's the value we put in here to make the Gibbs free energy change correct for a real gas. So if we were to subtract these two equations, the real and the ideal, and just divide by RT to make dimensionless, then the right side we'd have d log fugacity over pressure, and this is the fugacity coefficient, a dimensionless variable. So if we were to go back and remember that our constant temperature dg is vdp, we could subtract that equation for a real gas, so without the symbol, this is real, ideal gas, and we could write this in terms of a compressibility factor z. And compressibility factor is 1 for an ideal gas, dp. So z minus 1 rt dp over p tells us this change in difference between ideal gas and real gas. And note that as pressure approaches 0, then g approaches the ideal gas value. So the real gas value and the ideal gas value for Gibbs free energy are the same at low pressures where gases become ideal gases. So this means an ideal gas, the fugacity is just the pressure. For real gas, we have to use information like the equation of state, integrate this to determine the fugacity because we have change in Gibbs free energy in terms of z. We also have it in terms of fugacity and pressure. And so if we combine these equations and won't go through the details, then fugacity at given pressure for an ideal gas is equal to this integral, 0 to the pressure we're interested in, compressibility factor minus 1 dp over p. And so we use an equation state, we can do this integration and determine fugacity for a real gas, any pressure. Ideal gas, we know fugacity. So the question is, for a liquid, what is the fugacity? So the thing that is critical is to keep in mind what we showed way back here. The Gibbs free energy in the liquid and the vapor are the same at equilibrium. So we're looking at a one-component system. If the Gibbs free energy in a liquid equals the Gibbs free energy in a vapor, that means from our definitions, the fugacity in a liquid is the fugacity in a vapor. And so at vapor-liquid equilibrium, we have both phases present, the fugacity in the vapor is going to be the saturation pressure if it's an ideal gas. That means the fugacity in liquid is the saturation pressure if indeed the saturation pressure is low enough that we can assume ideal gas. So now we have fugacity in a vapor for an ideal gas. We have a way of calculating fugacity for a gas that's not ideal, if we have more information about how non-ideal it is. And then for liquid, at saturation conditions, the fugacity is the pressure. For liquid at higher pressure, so liquid where the pressure is greater than the saturation pressure, first thing to realize is not much changes. So the liquid does not change its properties very much as we increase the pressure, enthalpy, internal energy, entropy, etc. don't change, and since G is H minus TS, if enthalpy and entropy don't change much, it means the Gibbs free energy doesn't change very much. And so there indeed is a small change, and this small change, in the interest of time here, the fugacity would be fugacity at saturation pressure, which is going to be very close to the saturation pressure. And then just from that definition, we have this exponential. This term is close to 1, and so it takes high pressures to change the fugacity very much for the liquid phase.